Cześć, jak pisałem na Facebooku 13 lipca, czyli 13 piątek w zeszłym tygodniu, miało miejsce nagranie z pewnym specjalnym gościem. Nagranie, rozmowa, wywiad, jak zwał, tak zwał, jednak okazało się, że z przyczyn technicznych, czyli z mojej głupoty, ponieważ nie odciszyłem ścieżki Skype'a w mikserze audio. Po 41 minutach nagrania została płaska kreska. Na szczęście udało nam się nagrać to drugi raz. Pojawiły się nowe pytania, pojawiły się te same pytania, co w pierwszym nagraniu. Zapraszam Was na rozmowę z trenerem naszej kadry, Mike'iem Taylorem. Coach, you were in Las Vegas last week. Can you tell us something about the trip?
Las Vegas is like the hub, the center point of professional basketball in the summer. Not only do you have the NBA Summer League out there, but you have many overseas tryout camps. And I love to go out there and see friends from all over the world, all kinds of different leagues, whether it's NBA guys coaching in the USA, guys coaching in different countries in Europe or different places around the world. A lot of people are there. You can meet people. You have a great chance to network, catch up with your friends. I saw several people from the PLK, so it was good to see them. This is a great place to see a lot of players in a short amount of time. So it's a great place to sign free agents. Obviously, with my new team in Hamburg, that's the main point to go out there. But obviously, we've been to the Summer League in the past when Big Mamba played there, Mateusz played there, Tomasz Gielo played there. It's always great to support the Polish players when they have these NBA opportunities to get a look and an NBA evaluation. So Las Vegas is a great place for basketball. There's lots of action, lots of stuff going on. And then in the background, you have the great city of so many things, so much entertainment, so much stuff to do. So I think it's a nice stop. I was there for a week. And it was very productive. Went to some of the pro tryout camps, overseas tryout camps, saw some of the NBA Summer League games, had some individual workouts. I spoke at Pro Scout School, so that was a really good experience. So in general, just a very positive week out there and got a lot of things done.
I wonder, a lot of coaches like you going to Las Vegas and, as you said, scout some players with friends and so on. But do you feel any competition in that matter?
No, I think, Michal, what you try to do is you target the guys that you're after early. And what I like to do is I like to do my work before Vegas. So, for example, going out there, you have a list of maybe two or three guys at each position that you really consider as options for your team. What I like to do is track these guys, whether they're in the NBA Summer League or at these overseas tryout camps. So you go see them play, you meet them, maybe take them to a dinner. Get a chance to get around them socially, personally. And then what I also like to do is have gym time, private gym time. So I have some friends in the Las Vegas area that, you know, I can rent their gym out. And there's another private workout where the player gets to know the coach and the management and you get to know them. So I like to do my work early. Obviously, there's very good competition for these spots. And what you try to do is present your team, your organization, your situation as best it can be. But I think that if your friends are interested in other players and other guys, then that's great. And I think that you just have to be open and honest about different situations with the players that you're involved in. So, you know, I try to spend time with my really close friends, and I try to keep, you know, my close friends we're all on the same page. So I'm pretty open and I don't really hide a lot of, you know. Yeah, it's really good competition. And I think what it comes down to, it's more than just a player-coach relationship. It's about the level of the league. It's about the country. It's about the money. There's many factors that go into signing a player. So I don't think it's something that you should hide from, you know, your friends and things like this where you're out there scouting them in Las Vegas, for example.
Did you have a chance to see NBA Summer League competition?
No, every day. So the schedule is usually the overseas tryout camps are usually 8 a.m. till 12 noon. And the NBA Summer League usually starts around 1. So what we usually do is go to the morning workouts, pick different camps each day. There's several very good ones out there right now. So, you know, we would go to one camp one day, the next camp the other day, the next camp the other day. So you get a really good feeling for the players there. And then get some lunch. And then 1 o'clock, you're at the you know, the Thomas and Mack Center or the Cox Pavilion, and you're watching the NBA Summer League. So, you know, for us, for example, with Poland or Hamburg, my two situations right now, you're not really watching the Summer League to scout players. You know, those players are kind of above the level of Hamburg. So our target players were in the morning, and then it's kind of more relaxed, social. You get a chance to see some friends and watch some games together and catch up with people while the NBA Summer League goes on. So I watch games every night, basically in the gym from 1 till 10. And you bump into a lot of people, see a lot of people, and you get a chance to watch a lot of prospects out there for the NBA Summer League teams.
What do you think about Luka Doncic? Will Doncic be an NBA superstar or another very, very good player from Europe?
Well, I think that Luka Doncic is the most complete European prospect we've ever seen. You know, there was so much hype around Ricky Rubio when he came over, but Doncic is a more complete player. He's a better shooter. He's a better, you know, complete all-around playmaker, rebounder, defender, shooter with range. And I think Doncic, what he's done at his age to win a EuroLeague and to win a EuroBasket and to be an MVP, I mean, fantastic career to this point. But what we have to remember is that every player is different. Every player brings certain skills and abilities. Some players are more athletic. Some players are more flashy. The great thing about Luka is he's a complete player at his age. And that's why he's been able to play so well at the EuroLeague level with men. Remember when Dirk first came over from Würzburg, Germany to Dallas? It was not, you know, easy. It wasn't pretty right away. You know, it took him some time to adapt to the NBA. It took him some time to adapt to things. But I really think Dallas is a great fit for Doncic. I think they've done well with the European players. I think that they're going to help his transition. But I think the big thing for him is how can he create his own shot and his own offense at the NBA level with all the athleticism. I think that's the big challenge that he has to work his way through. And depending upon how he does that, that's going to be how high he rises and how quickly he rises. But in general, there's never been a more complete European prospect. I have really strong belief he's going to do extremely well. And now it's just about going through the transition into the NBA phase. He may look like a rookie at times, but that's okay because that's what he is. He's a young guy, a super talented young guy, and you hope that he can go through that transition as quickly as possible and establish himself as a very, very good NBA player.
What do you think about Isaac Bonga? Of course, he's so far from Doncic in skill set discussion, but Bonga is also a very talented guy from Europe.
Yeah, so what you're talking about is the expectations of Doncic have been so elevated because of all his accomplishments and so much is he the number one pick and all the hype about him. Without a doubt, sometimes that sets the expectations too high, makes them unrealistic for a player. You know, but when you compare Bonga and you compare Doncic, you know, Doncic is clearly the more skilled, the more experienced, the more intelligent player. Bonga is very athletic. He's got a lot of tools. But when you talk to the Lakers guys, when you talk to the people from Germany, you know, he's got a long ways to go. And I think that this is just the issue that let's say Doncic is more game ready right now. And Bonga, with his potential, with his talent, has a little bit more development needed.
Let's talk about real men, real money. In a few days, you are going to start the big heist on $2 million prize with Team Fredette, and you are going to coach it. So tell something about this league. It's not Transylvania Basketball League.
No,
TBT. It's not Transylvania.
The basketball tournament has been established a couple years in the USA now. It started as a $1 million tournament, and now it's bumped up to a $2 million winner-take-all tournament. You know, the team that I'm involved with, Jimmer Fredette coached the team last year. Everybody knows Jimmer Fredette from his great college career at BYU and then played in the NBA with several teams. He was in the D League for a while, and then now he's playing for big money in China. Jimmer's a great player, great shooter, really exciting. So he wanted to play, and his brother and some friends are the general managers and organizers of the team. So one of Jimmer's friends from childhood, EJ Gallup, played for me in Ulm, Germany, and I maintained a really good friendship with him over the years. So as they started talking about it, they're like, hey, you know, Mike T, why don't you come coach this team, Team Fredette? We'd love to have you. And I'm like, hey, that sounds great, but I got to try to balance it with my summer schedule from Poland. And then obviously we picked up the Hamburg Tower situation. So it had to fit in the perfect time. And it did here late July. So basically the connection from EJ, I coached Xavier Silas in the D League in Maine. So there's another connection. Sean Finn played for the team in the past. I coached him with EJ in Ulm. So there's personal connections throughout my coaching career that kind of made it a really nice fit with the team. And I think TJ Fredette, Dan Britton, the guys that are involved with organizing the team have done a fantastic job with the roster. It's a very, very good team. We're second ranked in the Midwest. We play our first games in Columbus, Ohio. And basically it's you win a game Saturday, you win a game Sunday, then you move on to the next week. You win a game Saturday, you win a game Sunday, you move on to the championship. So it's you got to win 6 games. You know, you survive in advance, win and move on, lose and go home. And it's, I think, really a high-level tournament. Some of the rosters and some of the players involved are great. And I'm a basketball guy. You know, I love to do basketball things, have different basketball experiences. So while I have some time here, free time in the summer, this was a perfect thing to keep coaching and keep meeting people, networking, and doing all kinds of different basketball things. So I'm really excited about it, the chance to work with some great players. The guy that's probably most interesting to Poland other than Jimmer would be Brandon Davies, played for Zalgiris Kaunas this year. Excellent power forward. So Jimmer and Brandon were teammates at BYU. And, you know, that's two of the, you know, main players on our team. But the rest of the guys have good European careers, good, you know, let's say G League, D League careers, some good players. And our headline guy is definitely Jimmer Fredette.
How is TBT similar to NCAA tournament? Of course, not counting the money prize.
Michal, that's really what it is. It's like a organized money tournament set up to be like the NCAA tournament. So this is what's really cool about it. Anybody that has experienced college basketball, it's a way to relive that or be involved in that again. You know, once you're done with college basketball, you're basically not playing in NCAA tournament again. So this is a way that, to get back into it. But I think that, you know, the TBT is going to be a lot of fun. You know, I'm really excited about the chance to work with these guys, but you know, it's really about the exposure. It's about the excitement to work with the good players and have some fun with basketball. That's really my motivation. And I'm really looking forward to the time with these guys.
Okay. Let's talk about your contract with Hamburg Towers. Your decision comes with a lot of discussion, heated discussion in media about your job in lower German league. Can you comment the whole thing?
Yeah, you know, Michal, I think that people from the outside may have a difficult time understanding all the things going on the inside. You know, there's certain name jobs and certain name leagues that people would automatically respect. Let's say, okay, Coach Taylor takes a job in Italy, Serie A. You know, there was some talks with one of the teams during my time. There was a talk with a Bundesliga team during my time. You know, I turned this situation down. There was talks with a team from the VTB league. You know, I turned that down. And then why does you know, he sign in second division Pro A Germany? And I think that the first point is that, you know, I love to build up organizations. I love to build up teams. Like take, for example, Rasha Farm Ulm. I coached there for 8 years, moved them up from the second league to the first league. Established them in the first league, and now they're a Euro Cup team, a very strong organization. When I went back to Maine, the team had struggled for years, and I kind of rebuilt it a little bit and made, you know, got it to the playoffs in the D League for the first time in the organization's history. And then when I came to Poland, obviously after Eurobasket 2013, the national team was not in a good position, not in a good place. We pumped some positive energy into it. We rebuilt it. And now, you know, we've had a great 5-year run. You know, good success the first 3 years. We struggled Eurobasket 2017, and we've advanced now into the second round of the World Cup qualifiers. So we're moving in a really good direction here in general from where Polish basketball was to where it is now. I think our FIBA world rank is 27. So, you know, there's visible signs of really development and steps forward, not only from our team, but from the players and things like this. So I love to build organizations. That's the first thing. And that's the main point with Hamburg. And when you look at Hamburg, the Hamburg organization, the people involved, the city, the gym, you know, we played in the Super Cup there twice in this gym. It's got such a high ceiling. So the main point is, why do you turn down a Bundesliga job and take a second league job? Well, it's because this Hamburg Tower job has such a high ceiling. You can develop it. You can really help it grow and build it. And I think that you can write a similar story like we did in Ulm, you know, with Hamburg. So my main point would be for these first two points, you know, to build the team is something that I'm really excited about, but also to the high ceiling in Hamburg. You know, the third point is family, you know, with Alice growing up in Germany, her father playing in Germany, Luke being born in Germany. It's a natural fit for us family wise, as we look to build up something and build up an organization. So for the people that maybe look at it and kind of don't understand now, like, why does the coach take a pro A job? Well, it's a great organization. It's got tremendous potential. And my hope is that after we can, you know, move up to the Bundesliga, we can really develop it. And 2 or 3 years down the road, people can look around and say, like, wow, this Hamburg Towers basketball organization is really developed and really established itself as one of the top organizations in Germany.
Hamburg was the first club from which the offer came out, or were there any other options to choose from?
When I compare, you know, some of the different teams in different leagues, what you look for is that organization that has something special that can really grow and develop into, you know, what you dream about. You know, and keep in mind now, you know, like I was 2 years ago, before I signed with Hamburg, I was really looking hard in Poland. And for one reason or another, talking with several teams, it didn't work out. You know, we had good conversations with several teams, and it was like, at the end, it was healthy. It was like, hey, listen, I really like your situation, but, you know, if you can't get A, B, C done, you know, let's say my minimum was above their maximum. There was a gap there. And if you can't meet and get those two things to work together, then it really doesn't make sense, you know? So there were several conversations with some of the PLK teams. That was obviously the place that I started because of Poland. And there was plenty of opportunity for, let's say, the Federation or other people to try to make these things work and help these things connect. Unfortunately, they didn't for one reason or another. And then I've kind of broadened my search, and really the connection with Hamburg is a great place. And I'm really excited about the future there.
So what is the plan for Hamburg Towers next season?
This is an organization that's only 4 years old. It's a very young organization. They've done a great job establishing the, let's say, youth programs. They've developed many youth players from the Hamburg city. You know, I think that they've done a great job with the community programs. So the foundation is in place for a very strong organization. What they need is improved basketball. They need someone to really step the basketball up. And that's kind of why they've hired me. We've kept, you know, a handful of players. We've got all of our German players in place. We've got 5 German players signed, 5 very good Germans, 2 guys at the center spot with Bundesliga experience, 2 point guards, 1 a homegrown product from Hamburg, and another guy who's won the second league, the Pro A, twice. So he's a real experienced point guard. We've got a really great prospect 3 who played in, you know, Bamberg and Ludwigsburg in his young career. And we've got 1 veteran Croatian wing who is like the heart of the team the last couple of years. So with those guys in place, we are just looking for, you know, 3 more import spots, which we've identified some guys in Vegas. So it's not really a total rebuild, you know. It's one of these things where the foundation is in place. You've got some good guys there already. We've made some decisions on the German players early. And now we're trying to find the right pieces to complement them with our import spot. So, you know, I think the time is right for Hamburg. You know, when you talk about the promotion and relegation situation in Germany, you know, let's say Tübingen moved down from the Bundesliga, Erfurt moved down, but Erfurt crashed financially. So they'll start in a lower league. The 4th place team, Cologne, also crashed financially. So they'll start in a lower league. Arland has moved up. Rostock has moved up, and you got to think these teams can be okay. But in general, you know, I think that what I like about the situation is we hope it can be, you know, if we do a good job with our team and maximize our team, that we have every opportunity to win and move up this year and achieve our goals of really starting something special in Hamburg.
Okay, let's talk about our national team. One of national team biggest issue is point guard position. Do you see any way to improve something in near future?
Yeah, you know, the thing about national teams, you have to make the best of what you have. You have to make the best of what you have in your country, in your situation. Łukasz Koszarek has been in my mind, a legend for Polish basketball in the way he's been so loyal to the national team and everything he's done. He's been great to work with. I've really enjoyed it. But a couple years ago, you know, our conversation started changing to, you know, coach, you know, I'm getting up in years and I don't know how much longer, you know, I can play. So when he brought this to my attention and we started having more of these conversations about, hey, you know, what my future is. And I think the big thing is we have to respect Vukas and everything he's accomplished and everything he's done. And when they brought that to me, I was like, okay, we need to do a couple things. First, we need to identify the top young talents, the up and coming talents, and develop them. We need to develop the point guards that have been, develop them better than have been for the last couple of years, because really it's been Košarić as your main guy. We need more prospects, more, you know, potential players. So we wanted to try to identify two. We put a number on it, two young prospects from the point guard position. And over the last couple of years, the last couple of summers, we've done that. You know, I think that first thing you look at Marcel Ponica. What Marcel has done is raise his, you know, level and raise his stock by playing so well in Treviso this summer. For me, it's really important Marcel plays the point guard position in whatever club he plays in, whether that's a Seco and things like this. He needs to play the point guard position to develop and master that position. So Marcel's the first one. You know, I think that you look at a guy like Shank, who's going to Szczecin. I think Shank has done a really good job at our developmental camp. I was really impressed with him, enjoyed working with him. I think he showed some flashes and raised his stock. I really like Andy Mazurchuk, who has been with our senior training camp and some B-team activities in the past. He just recently played in Chemnitz, Germany, and signed now in Spain. So he's another prospect that I'm really high on. And I think when you go even deeper, you know, maybe the bigger prospect of everyone can be Łukasz Kolenda. So Łukasz is doing a great job with the under 20 this summer. And I think that we need to invest in these young players to try to help them develop. And these four guys kind of are my main focus after evaluating most of the prospects for the last few years. Now, that's part of it. The second part of it, I think, is you look at the passport situation. And whether people want to make it into a controversy or a discussion or not, to me, that stuff is in the past. You know, you're talking about something that is, you know, it's by the rules. There's nothing illegal about it. And what you talk about is a competitive advantage. Now, if you're honest with yourself, we are not like Lithuania. We are not like Serbia. If you're going to put high expectations on the national team, and right now we're on the highest expectations, people expect us to advance out of the group in Eurobasket. People expect us to compete for medals. They expect us to, you know, get to the World Cup, which would be the second time in Polish basketball history. If you are going to put high expectations on the team, then you've got to give the team the best competitive advantage it can get. For us in Poland, that includes a passport player. I want to say this. With AJ Slaughter, over my time, we are 14-7 in official, you know, FIBA games. Without a passport player, we're 3-5. This clearly makes a difference for our team in a positive way. The passport player takes the pressure off of other players, helps the players, and helps the team function better. So this is my point. You have countries like Georgia or Macedonia or Montenegro giving two or three passports a summer. You have the European champion, Slovenia. You have Dragic, you have Doncic, and you give a passport to Anthony Randolph to complete the team. This is not up for debate. It's not anything illegal. This is about competitive advantage, the landscape of European basketball right now. So this is our situation. We need to clear out of that discussion, and we need to just move on to our next passport player. That's the first thing. But with AJ, everything that's happened with AJ, we can't close the door. You know, like I'm mad at AJ. I'm not happy about AJ. You know, we have open communication. I tell him how I feel. Not only for me, like he has a responsibility. If you are going to hold that passport, you know, you have a responsibility to come to play for the national team. You know, it's not just 1 or 2 years and you're done. No, you have got to come play. Now, he was caught up, like Adam Wachinski, in the EuroLeague FIBA situation. You know, AJ had what he thought was a second-year contract in ASVEL for a EuroLeague situation. ASVEL has now pushed the EuroLeague back to the next year, so it's EuroCup. But the biggest plus for us right now with AJ is the coach, the new coach in Azrael Mitrovic. He's the head coach of Montenegro. There is absolutely no excuse for AJ Slaughter not to come and play for us this next window. Like, he has to be there. If he's not there, then there's something really, really wrong. You know, we're already frustrated. We're already upset about the fact that he wasn't there. It was not communicated well. It was not handled well. So look, we've talked about it. We've expressed it to him. And I think that he was like Adam Vichinsky got caught up in, I've got to look out for my own personal contract, my own personal situation, because it's a big money contract, you know, and I get it. But like this past summer, I felt like, you know, to me, AJ should have been there. You know, and maybe that would have helped us play better against Lithuania. At the end of the day, it's a non-factor, because we advance in second place and we achieve our goal of moving to the second round in second place. But this is where it counts. This is where we've got a lot of work to do in the second round. We need to be at our best. Now, we just talked about the prospects, Micha. We just talked about the future. Young Polish point guards, you know, whether it's Marcel Ponitka, whether it's a Jakub Schenk, whether it's a Andy Mazurczyk, whether it's Łukasz Kolenda. Then you talk about having some passport options. So that's the game plan. But let's also recognize Kamil Wachinski has come in and stepped in, and he's helped our team over the last couple windows. You know, we've needed him. He's proven he's the most game-ready guy that we have after, you know, Łukasz Koszarek. And, you know, we have to appreciate what he brings to the table. So this kind of shapes up as the point guard position. And to me, that's the biggest issue that we have facing us right now. The easy answer is we get AJ to come play because he's the passport solution right now. But beyond AJ, there's got to be new passport options and there's got to be the new, you know, Polish prospects that are coming up. And hopefully, you know, we've started our process here the last 2 years to push things forward.
What can you say about the generation shift in our national team?
Well, again, you've got to make the best of what you have. And there's the natural generational shift. So some generations are strong with big men. For example, Gortat, Lampe, you know, Shevchik, Ignerski. This generation had good big men. You know, most recently, we've been missing some point guards. Right now we've got, I think, strong wings. I think Vichinsky, Ponitka are great examples of that. What you've got to be ready to do is push the next generation players in there and get them ready to compete while these players are in their window right now. So let's say Ponitka, Vichinsky, these type of players are in the window right now. Like, they're the best players. They're at their peak. They're in their prime. It's the best years for them. You've got to make sure that the generational shift can get players ready to help contribute. Now, will Kalenda be ready in the next year or two to try to help? We can hope. We can hope that he can. But again, this goes back to, if you want to maximize your team and you've got like a missing piece, say Łukasz Koszarek decides he's going to stop playing, the quick answer, the quick fix is to keep this window alive and maximize the team is, you know, according to the rules, naturalize a player in the position that you need. So for me, while you continue to develop these young Polish players and help them get ready, if you need high-level talent right now, you know, your one answer is the passport situation. May not be popular with a lot of people, but when you talk about, again, the competitive advantage, when you talk about, again, the high expectations, you know, I think if you're not going to, you know, supply your team with every, you know, chance to win, then it's really hard to have those really high expectations. Because you don't control the generational shift, you know. Maybe Kolenda is ready 3 years, 4 years from now. Where does that put Ponitka? Where does that put, Vichinsky? So this is the point. It's all about timing, and you've got to kind of keep that, make it an even flow, year to year, competition to competition with your roster.
Do we have fourth quarter issue or other issue connected to the focus of the team where we are losing at the end of the games?
So first of all, you know, you talk about problems in the fourth quarter. I think that you have to be careful of generalizing problems about a team. The situation in Finland can be boiled down to one or two possessions. And this is not a problem of the fourth quarter, right? This is an execution situation. And this is about, you know, just your team and how you play and how your efficiency with the basketball. I don't see our team as having fourth quarter problems. I see our team as having generally offensive issues that we've tried to deal with. Mija, when you look at our advanced stats, we grade out as an excellent defensive team from the last six games of the World Cup qualifiers. The advanced stats don't lie. They're telling you, you know, we have one or two players who grade out poorly as defenders. I'm not going to bring those names up, but our team is an excellent half-court defensive team. We are playing good enough defense to win these games. But like we saw, whether it was the game we won at home against Hungary, very inconsistent, struggling to score offensively. In Hungary, away, we missed 19 layups, you know, that cost us the game. We play here against Lithuania, and we play much better. We have runs. We have surges. But over the 40 minutes, it's not consistent. So here's my issue. My issue comes down to, you know, you're trying to maximize your personnel. You're trying to help players come together in a short amount of time. What people are overlooking is many teams are struggling like this. Many teams. The difference is when you have a Sabonis and a Valanciunas in the front court, high-level players, they make plays on their talent alone. This is the point that our guys are, you know, we're trying to play team basketball. The preparation of 3-4 days to practice, our situation with point guards, you know, specifically, it's one of these situations where we are not creating advantages on the offensive side, whether it's off pick and roll or beating players one-on-one. We're not creating easy shots for our teammates. And we've gotten better and better and better as the windows have gone, but we're still not consistent over the 40 minutes. Now, you know, people want to point to the Finland game, because that's the easy game to point to with our team. Oh, they were up 9 and they lost the game because of one thing or another. That's completely different situation from, you know, what's going on with our team in the windows. We're defending really well. We're playing excellent team defense. What comes down to is we've got to find a way to be more consistent on the offensive end, to create easier shots for us. And then we got to step up and make plays, whether it's finishing a layup, making free throws, hitting our threes. And I think, again, it's step by step by step, window for window for window, we've played better. And hopefully we can be at our best here as we get into the second round.
Tony Parker told that new system of qualifiers is wrong. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I think the main point here, when you talk to most of the coaches, the hardest part is you have three different teams. With your own team, you have three different teams for the three different windows, and your opponents have different teams. So it's really difficult when, for example, you know, a team plays against a team at full strength with NBA players during one window, and another team never has to face those NBA players with that opponent, you know. So I think that this is a real conflict that FIBA has to work out. And you can't just sweep it under the rug, because, you know, there's lots at stake here. There's many teams that are trying to get to the World Cup. Everybody's super competitive. And I think this is maybe a flaw within the competition system here. You know, for us, the way we try to do it is we try to compare or prepare for the best team an opponent can put together. So that means with Italy coming up, we're preparing for Gallinari. We're preparing for Datome. We're preparing for Gentile. We're preparing for Aradori, for De La Valle. We're preparing for, you know, the best players these guys can play, whether it's NBA, EuroLeague, whatever. So I think when that happens, then you just make your adjustments. You're ready for everything, the best they have, and then you just make your adjustments as you get into the really actual preparation. So, you know, you just go through your process. We've got a really well-established, you know, game preparation process. The coaches for 5 years have done a great job. You know, the staff, Vojta, Sub-Zero, Miwi, you know, Dominator, and Masi and everybody for 5 years, they've done a fantastic job. So we've really been ready. And you know, we'll continue to go through that process as we get ready for, you know, these NBA players from Italy, Croatia, and the rest of the windows after that.
I've got this on tape, coach. Joking apart, I hope we'll see our national team fighting for each win on any given possession.
Well, our goals are clearly to get to the second World Cup in Polish basketball history. You know, that's a high goal. We're all in. We're committed, and we're going to go for it. And okay, we advanced right where we should be. I think if you look at the first round, people would say Lithuania is going to win that group. Poland's going to finish second. Hungary's going to finish third. And Kosovo is going to be out. And even though we haven't played great basketball offensively, or we've kind of struggled with this problem or that problem, we've accomplished, you know, we're right where we need to be. So everybody's disappointed we lost, you know, in Hungary. That was a great opportunity to really help ourselves here for the second round. But whatever would have happened, whatever has happened, we still have a lot of work to do in this second round. So this second round is going to be a great fight. It's going to be, you know, tremendous competition. And I think our guys are going to love it. And we're going to battle for it. We're going to fight for it. We set those goals high. And we want to have the team in the best place possible to achieve our goals. We know, let's say, Lithuania at 6-0 has a great advantage to go through. Italy hurt themselves a little bit last window by losing both games. Now they're 4-2. They're back to the pack a little bit. We're 3-3. The other teams are 3-3. So we've got work to do. And hopefully we can get some really big wins here in these windows and make some things happen.
Okay, coach, two quickies. In 2030, your son will be a basketball player?
So Luke is great. So we were actually playing a little basketball last night, not on a real basket. Like, I'm the basket. He's shooting the ball into his mouth. Stuff. So he's having a lot of fun. I think that he'll be around basketball because of our family and the way I grew up with my dad, just being in the gym, being around his teams. So that's how I started to love basketball. And then the chance to spend time with my dad about basketball. So I think that Luke will definitely be involved with basketball because that's be a way that we spend time together. You know, Alice's dad has some really good size. You know, he's 6'9". So we hope that Luke gets some size, but we'll see. You know, the big thing is Luke loves to play sports. Classic boy, loves his cars and just running around. So we're trying not to pressure him into any specific sports, but I do think our family is so much based around basketball that he will be involved with it at some point. So I don't want to pressure him, but I'm sure we'll have fun when that time comes.
Second one about the NBA. Who will be the NBA champion next year?
But I'm going to go Boston Celtics. Those are my guys, you know, like those are my guys. You know, I just saw some of those guys out in Vegas and it was great catching up with them. And, you know, I had my great 2 years around the organization. So I think that with LeBron leaving, you got Philly and Boston in the East. They're going to battle. I think Boston has played great for the last few years, so I'm going to go with them. And everybody's going to talk about the West. Everybody's going to let the West kind of beat up each other. And whoever comes out of the West still has to play somebody from the East. And I think it's going to be Boston, and Boston's going to have a really good chance. So I would just go Boston. The only thing that concerns me about that is the situation with Kyrie Irving. Maybe they end up trading him. I don't know, but we'll see how things develop.
Do you think Lakers advance to the playoffs in the first season with LeBron or not?
Yes, they're definitely a playoff team. Look what LeBron did in Cleveland with some of the rosters he's had. They'll be a playoff team for sure. I just have a difficult time with some of the signings that they... I get Rondo because Rondo's so smart. And if he's ready to be a backup, then that can be one thing. Rondo's super competitive, so that'll be great for LeBron. But like the Stevenson, I just have a hard time, you know, wrapping my head around that one. I don't know. It's going to be really interesting to see how that transition goes. I think that it was more than basketball for him to sign there. And we'll see how things develop. But they're definitely going to be a playoff team. I just don't see them getting too far in the playoffs against some of these good teams in the West.
Thank you very much. Best of luck on all of your teams. First, your first game, TBT, will be 21st.
On ESPN, and it's going to be shown in Europe, too. You guys can watch it.
Thanks again, coach.
Ciao, ciao.